outlook for stocks, bonds, and the economy are tied pretty closely to the outlook of the central bank and its monetary policy. Joining us this morning, Philippine Central Bank Governor Felipe Medalla. Governor, good morning. Welcome back to Market Edge.
Well, good morning, and good morning to your viewers as well.
All right, Governor. Well, it seems like you have less problems this year. Would that be an accurate statement? I mean, last year you had to defend the peso and tame the inflation. This year it seems like the currency headache is out of the way with the peso already at 54, so you're left with just inflation.
Well, the other way to put it is that even the supply shocks, I think the worst is over. Because we got hit by high oil prices. Finally, the oil prices are... the oil shock is fading. Then we got hit by high sugar prices. We got hit by fruits and vegetables, name it. And then, of course, the fertilizer shortage resulted in higher food prices as well. So we actually look at what we call the month-on-month, that's after seasonal adjustment. And then some months were really terrible. Okay, 1 month, prices were up more than 1% in just 1 month. If you annualize that, that's 12%. And we had a series of that. We thought that the last bad month would be October or November. That didn't happen. We had another shock. But finally, the December print is, although the year-on-year is quite high, the month-on-month is back to a normal 0.3%. Of course, as they say, one person does not make a crowd, right? But if we see and hope, of course, that none of these supply shocks will become self-fulfilling expectations. The problem is if prices are high, and then as a result, people think prices will rise further, even if there are no other causes except expectations, then you have self-fulfilling or what we call second-order inflation. And then if the currency is falling as well, that will add to it, those expectations as well. Now, that's why we had to really act very aggressively. Okay, so to begin with, we had a very low policy rate because of the pandemic. So we had to exit from that. What happened was the exit had to be faster. And as you can see, now we have, 5.5 up in just since I became governor. It went from 2.25 to 5.5. So that's only 6 months. But I think the actions we have taken, number one, by the way, together with our intervention in Forex markets, are beginning to work, and fortunately the dollar also is not as strong as it used to be. So all of this together we are hoping, and we are assigning a high probability to it, we are hoping that by the third quarter of this year, inflation will be below 4%. Okay, and to do that, month-on-month inflation after seasonal adjustment should be between 2.2% and 0.4%. So we're beginning to, we have 1 month that's already like that. It happened 2 months later than we expected, but I think it's finally there.
All right, that's great. That's a great starting point. So, Governor, do you think that 2023 is going to be a year of small hikes, a little bit more, and then holding? I mean, yes, sir.
Yes, and a lot of this will be driven by our forecast of what the U.S. will do. I think the U.S. is no longer going to do what they call the jumbo 75s, right? because the U.S. did what? In just four meetings, 475s.
Back to back, yes, sir.
Yeah, so I think that's over. I think the demand is now more under control in the U.S. In contrast, the Philippines never really had excess demand, never really had labor market tightness. So, but in the case of the U.S., the both problems were there. Okay, plus the fact that supply shocks made, well, actually, some of the effect of the COVID and the pandemic on the supply chains was a lot more lasting than people expected. So, and then some people who dropped out of the labor force did not come back. So when you combine all of that, what you're seeing in the U.S. is a much stickier inflation than in the Philippines. Mm-hmm. So, but I think in addition, Europe, the European economy, is the European Central Bank is also raising interest rates. And hopefully supply problems from China will also begin to be addressed as the Chinese themselves are reducing the lockdowns. Mm-hmm. So when you put those all together, our main scenario is about 4.5% average inflation this year, because the first semester is still above target, but the second semester will be within target, but could not offset the high inflation of the first semester. Mm-hmm. But then 2004 actually could be below 3%, a little bit below 3% to 2024.
All right. Governor, would you say categorically that you are close to completing your rate hikes? We're at 5.5%. Some are saying it's just another 25 or 50 basis points for the rest of the year before you take a pause.
I guess unless new bad things happen, right? Mm-hmm. I think the analyst assessment is more or less similar to ours.
Okay, and sir, when are you going to start thinking about cutting rates?
Well, it's hard to cut rates when the U.S. is not, because the problem is that many Philippine investors and even foreigners who invest in the Philippines looks at what we call the interest rate differential. Now, I ask people this question. Suppose you have a dollar bond and a peso bond with exactly the same maturity. What would happen if they have the same interest rate? Which one would you prefer? And I have yet to see a person who would prefer the peso bond to the dollar bond if the interest rate is the same. So the same goes for policy rates. If for some reason the people seem to think that the appropriate risk-rewarding differential between U.S. and Philippine policy rate is between 1 and 1.25. Percent. So if the U.S. is increasing policy rates, we need not match that, but we cannot, if it's 50, I think it's hard not to match, it's hard not to respond, at least partially.
All right. Governor, what about your view on the economic activity this year? Let's not forget that this year the base effects will be gone, so we're going to have to earn whatever growth the number shows. What is your realistic base case for GDP?
Our base scenario is growth above 6%, because there's still quite a bit of pent-up demand. For instance, a lot of people have yet to go back to Boracay. A lot of people have yet to go back to Palawan. So there's still quite a bit of that, and people who postponed buying major items. You could still see this, for instance, in the case of car sales. They're now double digit, you know, growth.
Up 31% last year, sir. Yes.
Yes. So what's happening is that demand that was postponed for expenditures, that major expenditures that were postponed for what? More than 2.5 years. That's not fully back yet. So this year we still have some of that. We still have some of that pent up demand.
Okay. Governor, of course, there are other tools in your war chest, not just raising rates or holding them. I know that last year there was a delay in cutting the reserve requirement ratios. What's the latest on that, sir?
Okay, we don't want to confuse the markets. It's hard to be raising policy rates and cutting reserve requirements. Although we should be able to do that because we can offset the cut in the reserve requirements by increasing our borrowings. But given the situation, the last thing we want to do is confuse the signals.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So therefore, when we are no longer under pressure to raise policy rates, then we will cut, because we don't think it's healthy to have a 12% reserve requirement. Not only that, we had also a temporary relief measure
for SMEs.
Making loans to MSMEs, right, qualify as reserves, fulfillment of reserve requirements. Mm-hmm. That's going to end. So we have to replace that a temporary measure by a permanent measure, which is a cut in the RRR.
Do you think that cut, sir, might happen this year?
I think that will happen. The likelihood that it will happen the first semester is quite high.
Okay, quite high. All right. And what about the reserves? Governor, you've burned through a lot of reserves trying to defend the Philippine peso last year. There was a commitment the peso will not hit 60. You did good on that. It seems to have worked. But is it now time to rebuild the reserves we've burned through?
We buy whenever there are buying opportunities. I will not tell you what the exchange rate is, but certain exchange rate, we start buying. Mm-hmm. And fortunately, there have been quite a bit of buying opportunities lately.
Okay.
So our strategy is let the markets determine the exchange rate, but if we think that it's appreciating and actually overshooting on the appreciation side, then actually it's a good thing for us to start buying.
All right.
Still, even after we sold all those dollars, our reserves still remained comfortable. And of course, the reason we're buying more when the opportunity comes is we want it to be even higher. The general rule about reserves is they're so high, people think you'll never run out. And therefore, when the central bank says, we don't like what's happening, the markets listen. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, the last situation you want to be in is what happened in the, 97, 98. When we sold the foreign exchange, when the central bank sold foreign exchange, instead of that calming the markets, people said, hey, the reserves of the central bank are very low, cannot go on doing that. Mm-hmm. So actually, it could backfire. And we want to put in a situation where selling dollars actually is a strong signal that the BSP is unhappy about what's going on with the exchange rate, is in a position to make a difference.
All right. All right. And on that note, Governor, thank you so much for the time and for the insight, sir. Thank you and Happy New Year.
To you. Happy New Year to you as well, Mimi. Thank you for having me.
Thank you, sir.